Hello, Blu-ray Boutique listeners, and welcome to another episode. I am your co-host, Rosalie Lewis.
And I'm your other co-host, Tim Rosenberger.
And this lovely summer, we decided to focus on a trilogy of films that I think Tim and I both wonder if it may one day be more than a trilogy. And that series is the Before series. So Before Sunrise, Before Sunset, and Before Midnight, all directed by Richard Linklater and all starring Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy. So this is significant timing because the original three movies have sort of come out every 9 years or so, and the characters in them, we catch up with them somewhat in real time of, you know, the gaps that have taken place. And so this summer would be that natural ninth year to have another iteration of the series. Unless a major surprise drops in the next month or so, it seems like this year we will not get a fourth one. But that said, we're excited to talk about the ones that have come before. Yes, that was intentional. I should note that these have been released by Criterion as a trilogy set, and you can buy them on Blu-ray. And also for the rest of the month, at least, they are streaming on the Criterion channel, and you can even watch some of the special features, which is great. So, Tim, this was your pick. I also, of course, love these movies. And I think that your history with them goes back just a couple of years, right?
Not even that. I watched the first one, I think, because I got the bought the trilogy of films the last sale they had. So I bought them last July, and I watched the first one right near the end of July. So it's been, as we record this, it's only been about a year since I first watched the first one.
That's right. Only a year. Wow. I feel like time both goes by fast and sometimes slow. But
then we'll be talking about that.
Yeah, these movies are kind of all about time, right? And its effects. So what about these movies at a very high level made you want to talk about them on the podcast?
As the youngins with memes say, I just think they're neat. Yeah, I just really, really love them. And we'll talk about why and stuff, and why I personally hold them in such high regard, and why they are, I use them as my benchmark for certain different things regarding movies.
And had you previously watched a lot of Richard Linklater movies? He's done, of course, Slacker, Dazed and Confused, Waking Life. He did Boyhood, which actually took place and was filmed over an extended period of time, also similar to these movies. So had you had a lot of exposure to his work?
As of right now, I have seen Boyhood. I did see Waking Life, which, oddly enough, we'll mention it again at some point in this podcast. I did see, what was that one called? It was like Fast Food Nation or something.
Yep, Fast Food Nation, based on the Eric Schlosser novel, I believe. School of Rock, maybe?
I did see School of Rock. There might have been one or two other things in there somewhere. But yeah, those are some of the main ones. There's a lot of his work I haven't seen. He does keep himself busy. He's usually releasing something every 2 or 3 years. So mostly like what I've seen of his. Some stuff I haven't cared for, but yeah.
So my own history with these movies goes back a bit farther. Mm-hmm. I believe it was in the early 2000s that I first encountered Before Sunrise. And I watched it for very superficial reasons. I had a crush on Ethan Hawke, and I was watching a bunch of movies that Ethan Hawke was in, and this happened to be one that my local video store had, so I watched it not having any idea really what it was about, other than it's Ethan Hawke. And I was very pleasantly surprised. I remember being curious, like, what else was going to happen in the movie, because there wasn't obviously too much of a plot. But I really was charmed by the characters. And so then, you know, a little bit later, I was able to catch up with, you know, the next installment, Before Sunrise. I think I watched that one a couple of years later. Before Sunset, not Before Sunrise. And then I also, of course, watched Before Midnight when it came out in theaters in 2013. I also was able to go to the Siskel Theater in Chicago, and they actually did a retrospective that had all three movies playing back to back to back, which was really unique to see them that way. Of course, I sort of did that this week also, seeing them all in one day. And it's a different feeling that I think you get if you watch them as they came out. But, I didn't have that opportunity to do the 9 years apart. So I'd be curious how other people's experiences with these compare. But nonetheless, I am a Linklater fan. I haven't seen every single one of his movies, but I've seen quite a few that I love. And this one, is probably, even though it's kind of a non-traditional story structure, it's the most traditional movie he had made up to that point. Because before that, he did Slacker, which was very unstructured. It really just follows different people around the city of Austin, and there's no story to speak of at all. And then Dazed and Confused, which is a fun movie, but it's really just kind of a hangout movie. So Before Sunrise, I think, has a little bit more of a focus than those previous two did. Let's go ahead and start with the very first one, and that is Before Sunrise. So, this movie, which came out in 1995, like I said, it starred Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy and very few other people. They do encounter other folks, but they're definitely the stars of the show. And we meet these two characters, Jesse and Celine, as they are on a train in Europe. Celine is the one that we meet first. She's sitting on the train, and there's a couple arguing in German next to her, and she decides to move. And it just so happens that she moves to a seat that's near Jesse, played by Ethan Hawke, and they realize that they both are around the same age and they both speak English, and they're also sick of hearing this couple arguing in German. So they decide to go get some food in the dining car, and they strike up a really interesting conversation. And as the conversation unfolds, it's clear that they have some chemistry. And Jesse is planning to get off in Vienna while Celine is going back to Paris. But he manages to convince her in a very memorable speech.
I want to keep talking to you. I have no idea what your situation is, but I feel like we have some kind of connection, right?
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, right. Well, great. So listen, here's the deal. This is what we should do. You should get off the train with me here in Vienna and come check out the town.
What?
Come on, it'll be fun.
What would we do?
I don't know. All I know is I have to catch an Austrian Airlines flight tomorrow morning at 9:30, and I don't really have enough money for a hotel, so I was just going to walk around. And it'd be a lot more fun if you came with me. And if I turn out to be some kind of psycho, you just get on the next train.
Let me get my bag.
And it really follows from there. They do that very thing. They walk around together. They have interesting philosophical conversations.
How old are these?
Around the beginning of the century or so. It's called Cemetery of the No Name because they often didn't really know who those people were. Maybe a first name, that's all. I always liked the idea of all those unknown people lost in the world. When I was a little girl, I always thought that if none of your family or friends knew you were dead, then it's like not really being dead. People can invent the best and the worst for you. Oh, here she is, I think. Yeah, this is the one I remember the most. She was only 13 when she died. That meant something to me, I was that age when I first saw this. Now I'm 10 years older and she's still 13, I guess. That's funny.
They share little vignettes of each other's lives and tell stories.
Describe for me your first sexual feelings towards a person.
Jean-Marc Fleury. I remember we had this summer camp together and he was a swimmer.
Yeah.
Yeah, he had bleached out chlorine hair and green eyes. And my friend Emma had a big, big crush on him. So one day I was cutting, cross field back to my room and he came walking up beside me. And I told him, you should date Emma because she has a big crush on you. And he turned to me and said, well, that's too bad because I have a big crush on you. So, yeah, it really scared the hell out of me because I thought he was so fine. And then, officially asked me out on a date. I was so afraid of, what I might do, So, I went to see him swim a few times at the swim competition, and he was so sexy, really. I mean, really sexy. We came wrote these little declarations of love to each other at the end of the summer, and, you know, promised we would keep writing forever and, like, you know, meet again very soon.
Did you?
Of course not.
They eat food, they encounter interesting people, and of course, a romance develops as well. So that's the basic premise of the movie. There's not a lot of plot other than that, but it's a really charming way to spend your time.
Well, I would like to point out, before we get into specifics about what we think about them, just a little thing that I was unaware of, because I've done, as of this recording, I've done video pieces on the first two films, not on the third one yet. But what I was unaware of when I was writing my original piece for the first one was that in the credits for the film, Richard Linklater, I mean, obviously he's director, and he's credited as one of his co-writers, along with somebody he's worked with a little bit on some of his other films in various capacities, a woman called Kim Krizen. And they're the two credited screenwriters. However, from what I have heard from interviews with Julie Delpy, when Julie Delpy and Ethan Hawke were officially hired for the film, Richard Linklater encouraged them to essentially add in their own stuff into it. And so they, according to Julie Delpy, I think she said they rewrote most of the script, at least from Celine's end of it. I think there's only one or two lines from the original script still in the film, according to her. So I forget the percentage of it, at least in terms of her stuff. I mean, I don't know, I'm saying like everything in the film, but at least for her end of it, there was a lot that was still there, but maybe there's more of the rest of the film. But anyway, essentially a lot of the film, at the very least, probably over half, if not more, was rewritten of it. However, they are not credited in the film. They are credited screenwriters in the next two films, but not in this one. I think, according to her, it was due to, like, I think SAG rules and legal stuff. Except she said basically since they weren't hired to be screenwriters, they couldn't be credited with it or whatever. And I guess they were both fairly annoyed that they weren't credited for it. But anyway, what are some of your initial thoughts about it, Rosalie?
The first time I remember seeing this, I was very caught up in the romance of it. It's a very young person's movie in that way. Mm-hmm. The idea of getting off a train with a stranger, spending the night with them, falling in love with them, and knowing that there's probably not going to be a future in it, but still going with it anyway. It just felt very, you know, something out of a fairy tale almost. And I also loved how talky it was, because it reminded me of, you know, conversations that my friends and I would have either in college or, you know, people I grew up with, of those nights where you just walk around, probably because you're broke, right? I remember my friends and I would sometimes just go hang out at Walmart because it was the only thing in my small town that was open 24 hours. And we would just walk around, goof off, talk, drink way too much coffee, you know, look at the CDs that were in the music section, and just have these somewhat inane conversations, but also sometimes deeper conversations where it seemed like we were stumbling onto profound thoughts, even if maybe if I heard myself now, I would think otherwise, right? But it just, this kind of back and forth where you just have such a kinetic conversation with someone that you almost can't stop yourself from talking to them or listening to what they have to say. It felt very familiar and also very intimate. Like, we're really hearing this conversation that is unfolding in real time and seeing these little looks that they give each other, or the way they look away from each other when they start to get a little self-conscious, and sharing these experiences. It really just felt like there was so much possibility. And seeing this again, probably 20 years from the time I first saw it, and I've seen it many times in between, this one feels, I look back with nostalgia, but I also still love it, because even though I kind of know how their lives are going to play out because I've seen the other two movies, I love this little snapshot of them in one night and all the ideas that they had and whether or not they do or don't come to fruition. And it reminded me of my previous self and all the things that I thought I was going to do, or, you know, the way I thought I would be in the world. And, you know, those things don't always turn out that way. But it's fun to revisit that excitement.
This film in particular, there is a certain, obviously, romanticism in more ways than one. There's an idealism in it, which kind of sets the stage for all the other films. But one thing I found interesting, Richard Linklater talked about, you know, he would always hear about, like, oh, you know, show, don't tell, and stuff like that, you know, with screenwriting, or with stories in general. And he felt like you know, he didn't always necessarily agree with that. And like, especially when, you know, you're meeting somebody, he's like, well, you know, when you're meeting somebody, in my experience, you kind of get to know them through talking. So I just had them talk. And he said something, I forget exactly how he phrased it, but maybe I'm misinterpreting it. But the way I took what he said after that was, it's almost beneficial because, for me anyway, when I watch the film, the talking, when they're basically just describing stuff, it's kind of like a film we've talked about here before, My Dinner with Andre, where they're just talking about stuff, but you don't have any flashbacks, you don't have any visual cues about what they're talking about. You're just hearing these things and picturing people and events in your mind. And because of that, it almost works like like how you would show something in a book. In the sense that you're hearing these events and then you're picturing them in your head. So while you're being told them sort of through dialogue, you're kind of being shown them through the dialogue too. So that still, I think, really works. And again, like Richard Linklater said, people get to know each other through talking. And yeah, so it's an interesting way to do the film. And I think it's very brave to do that. I've heard them talk about the films and that they try to get rid of all, I can never say this word right, but all artifice. As much as possible. And so the acting, I've heard some people say it's naturalistic acting. I think I've heard them say something closer to like non-acting. Basically, they try to act as little as humanly possible in these films. It's all very well rehearsed. I know a lot of people say that, I think it's like ad-libbed, but it's not. Apparently, it is rehearsed to the point where they said all their physical gestures and stuff for scripted too. I don't know if it's all of them or just the main ones, but they said all of them. But all the dialogue is strictly what is in the script. All the time they talk over each other is very scripted. So it's all very, 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 very structured to get the result of it seeming spontaneous and stuff. And it's very, these films are all very simply photographed. They're not terribly showy, but I think that works for the film as well. So yeah, very simple films in many ways in one.
Yeah, I was interested in some of their conversational topics too. So one of the early ones that Jesse brings up, I think it's even while they're still on the train, is he wants to pitch a TV show that's just 24 hours a day of normal people doing normal stuff. And I'm like, oh, well, that's like reality TV, right? But at the time, Celine's like, oh, nobody would watch that. That sounds so boring. She's like, it's like National Geographic, but with people. Mm-hmm. And, you know, now that's very commonplace. But then on a more meta level, I'm like, well, that's also kind of what we're watching in this movie, is like normal people kind of doing normal things. And that's kind of what happens with Boyhood as well, is, you know, kind of watching a young kid grow up. But for some reason, it does resonate. So I think Jesse was onto something there. And his character, I think throughout these movies, right, tends to be more humanist and sees the good in things and, you know, tends to be a little bit more idealistic, even though in this movie, he's just had a breakup. And so he's, in theory, claims to be like losing his romance, but he's definitely very romantic. He says like people have romantic projections, but they're not based on anything. But it's like, well, okay, but you asked a girl that you didn't know to get off the train and walk around with you, so you have those two, right?
Yeah, he's a romantic who's trying to pretend to be a cynic. But yeah, he is. Yeah, he's idealistic. He's romantic, and Celine is too. But yeah, she's more. Oh, and we'll get to this as we get into some more of these films. She is a bit, I guess you could maybe say, a bit neurotic in some ways. She's a bit more of a worrywart and overthinks things. Maybe blows some things more out of proportion than they really should have. And that kind of comes into play in some of the other films. But yeah, they're both just these very romantic people, just very into the idea of having their one true love. There's a line that I really love and is really personal and means a lot to me, where Celine says,
loving someone and being loved means so much to me. I always make fun of it and stuff, but isn't everything we're doing in life a way to be loved a little more?
That means a lot to me, and that's kind of how I feel about stuff.
I like Celine's discussion about, you know, her parents always trying to get her dreams to become something practical. Like,
I'd say to my dad, I want to be a writer. And he'd say, journalist. I'd say, I wanted to have a refuge for stray cats. And he'd say, veterinarian. I'd say, I wanted to be an actress. And he'd say, you know, TV newscaster. It was this constant conversion of my fanciful ambition into this practical money-making ventures.
It was always kind of trying to pull her back down to the ground. And she wants to live in the clouds. She wants to do things that aren't necessarily practical, but that touch something bigger than herself or bigger than what she can see. And another thing that she mentions in this movie is that she is afraid of death, which is why she's on the train, because she doesn't want to fly. So I thought that was interesting too, kind of pulling at those two things, because those themes might recur again in future movies that we'll talk about. So I enjoyed kind of getting that background for this character, because I had forgotten, especially her comments about, you know, being afraid of death. But one of the things that, one of the scenes that I think is a key to this movie is the palm reader scene. So there's a palm reader that comes up to them, and Jesse dismisses her and is, you know, oh, this doesn't mean anything, and she's just, you know, trying to get money from us. But then Celine allows her to read her palm and gives her the coin and listens to what she has to say. And it seems like the palm reader kind of senses that, you know, these two just met. And so she tells her some things about that. And one of the things she says is, you need to resign yourself to the awkwardness of life. And I feel like Celine is going to struggle with that concept for the rest of the time we know her. She's not great at resigning herself to anything, right? She's just, she likes to think things through, and, you know, she sees herself as the rational one, but Jesse also thinks he's the rational one. So that does kind of set up some interesting dynamics between the two of them.
I think they both have trouble resigning themselves to the awkwardness of life, really. And they both are, you know, have this great bond that we see in this film, or and become great, develop this great love in this film. And we'll talk about this more when we talk about the last film, but that kind of bites them in the butt a little bit.
So I wanted to talk a bit about the poem. So they encounter this guy who asks them for money, but he doesn't just want to beg for money. He also wants to give them something. And so he tells them he'll write them a poem. They just need to give him a word. And I remember when I first watched this, I was like, that would not happen in real life. And then I was in New Orleans this past spring, and I realized that it's possible that this was already happening back in the day. And, you know, it's not influenced at all by the movie, but also it could be. There was somebody on the street who had a typewriter and piece of paper and said, you know, would you let me write you a poem? And, you know, in exchange, if you think it's worth something, you can give me money. So I did. And it was great. I don't think it was at the level of Delusion Angel, but it was still pretty great. So I do want to just read through the poem, because I think the poem really sets the standard and sets the whole trilogy in motion in a way, which they couldn't have known in 94 was going to be the case. But I do think it informs that. So I won't read the whole thing, but basically it's by a poet named David Jewell, who I think is from Illinois and moved to Austin at some point. And the part that I really like, that I think kind of speaks to the future films, is when he says, I am a delusion angel. I am a fantasy parade. I want you to know what I think. Don't want you to guess anymore. You have no idea where I came from. We have no idea where we're going. And then a little further down, he says, we're like branches in the river flowing downstream, caught in the current. I'll carry you. You'll carry me. That's how it could be. Don't you know me? Don't you know me by now? And that's how it ends. And I think that especially the don't you know me by now is going to echo into Before Midnight, but I don't want to get ahead of myself.
Well, you know, I think we'd be remiss if we did not talk specifically about, and I'm sure we'll talk about them more as we go through these films, but if we didn't talk specifically about Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy as actors in these films. I commend them tremendously for the work they did. I can't imagine how much of a pain in the butt it would be to just memorize the lines of these films. Again, like My Dinner with Andre, there was a lot of talking. There's, unlike, I can't remember if My Dinner with Andre, if there were a lot of long takes or not. It's kind of hard to remember just because that film is just people talking at a table. Well, this one, they're moving to different places, but there was a lot of long takes in this one and then on all of them. And I think in the first and second one, there would have been longer ones if they'd been shooting with digital. They were somewhat restricted because of physical film. You can only record for so long. But yeah, there's a lot of long takes in this film, a lot of long speeches in this film. And just, again, the fact that they are trying to not show that they're acting as much as possible, I think, is just very difficult. I don't think they succeed 100% of the time, but they do most of the time. I don't think all the lines always feel 100% not scripted. Some of the more deep ones feel like, okay, that seems a bit something like something somebody would write, but it's not like awful. It's just it slightly doesn't work. But I have to commend them just for, they do a tremendous job at making these things that they've rehearsed again and again and again and again and again and again and again seem completely off the cuff and wonderful. And the characters that they show us in, you know, over the course of, in the film, a course of a, you know, again, a 12, 18 hour period, are fully fleshed out. They are fully real. They have, to me, these two actors, even though they've said in real life, I think in most every interview they've given, that they have absolutely no romantic interest in each other at all as people, they have great chemistry as actors to show that they have, to pretend that they have romantic inclinations to each other. And they're kind of, it's kind of the romantic, this and these films and probably Marty are kind of the benchmark for what I set romantic chemistry in films as. I could compare other films to these ones a lot. So yeah, I love them all on all three films. They do such a great job. And I think helps highlight, I mean, a lot of people I think would have seen Ethan Hawke in a lot of stuff, especially if you're American and stuff. He's obviously more prolific, at least in the States and stuff. And Julie Delpy, people will probably be a little bit less familiar with, especially in more recent years, as she's done more behind the scenes stuff and had more bigger gaps between her projects. But, you know, I hope this shows people the brilliance of Ethan Hawke as an actor, but also helps introduce people to Julie Delpy as well, because they're both really good in this.
Yeah, if your only familiarity up to this point with Ethan Hawke are things like, you know, Training Day or some of the horror movies that he's done in recent years or things like that, or maybe, you know, like me, you saw Reality Bites back in the day and you had a crush, ill-advised crush on that character and decide you want to watch more Hawke movies. He's very different in this, right? He just seems like a real person in a way that, you know, even his best performances in other movies, I don't think can touch. And to your point, that's really hard to do, especially when you're doing these takes probably over and over again. And you've got a crew. I saw like a little 9-minute behind the scenes for both this and Before Sunset. And, you know, you see the crew really up close and personal around them. So this thing that seems like it's just an intimate conversation between two people, keep in mind, there's cameras really close to them. There's people holding, you know, screens to like bounce the light. There's, you know, mics and things. And so, and they're having to do this over and over again. And oftentimes, you know, if it takes place at night, which a lot of this movie does, they were doing night shoots, which is exhausting, right? So there's a lot more that goes into it that we don't see, which makes what we do see all the more magical to me. And I love seeing these actors grow in their chemistry with each other. I feel like as the movies go on, you know, there's obviously they're building on their previous work with one another. But in this movie, it is amazing to see how much chemistry they really did have. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it feels very real.
Yeah, and it's something that not all actors can do. I know Julie Delpy said that a friend of hers had asked her if she could write or help write a script kind of in the Before Trilogy style of conversational and non-acting and stuff. And when a friend got it, she said, well, this is really hard. It's like, yeah, it's really hard to do and stuff, to act it and all that stuff. Yeah, I can't imagine how hard it is. And I know, I think Julie Delpy said for her, that's the hardest thing of the movies, is just to act like you're not acting. So, yeah, because if you do a little bit too much, and in scenes, she references at the end of the last film, she said that, and I won't get into what that scene is, but she said that if she gave a little bit too much in that scene, then you're going to be demanding a little bit more of that scene. But if you give too little, if you gave too little in that moment, then the scene just doesn't work. And that scene and possibly the whole film falls apart. So, yeah, it's this very difficult thing where you can't give too much, you can't give too little. But it works. And I think, again, back to the simple shooting style of the film, I think to all these films, it helps. Because if you had really complicated shooting things and if you're too focused on cinematography and stuff, then you're distracted by that. But because Linklater is shooting it with really long takes, one, you have to get it kind of right. Because I know I think the second and third film were only shot within, like, they were shot in a span of like 15 days or something, which is very short for feature films. And this one, I'm assuming, I think it was around the same amount of time. They might have had a little bit more time. But you don't have a lot of time, so you, a lot of times, I don't know how many takes they did of stuff, but you probably didn't have many takes. You probably just had to go with it. And if you mess up, you just have to go with it. So, but because of those long takes and even, you know, the uncomplicated camera setups and stuff, you can kind of just focus. One, you feel more like you're with them as they're talking, and you can kind of focus more on just them as people instead of being distracted by all these other things. It keeps your focus very tightly on those two people and the relationship that they're developing.
Yeah, I mean, that said, it's a beautiful setting, right? No, Vienna is just in itself a gorgeous place to shoot. And I have to give some props to Lee Daniel, the cinematographer, because it was probably tempting to overemphasize the scenery because it is so beautiful. And if you did that, it would take you out of the moment because you really want it to feel real and grounded and almost like a documentary. Whereas, you know, if they shot it the way that probably the instinct would be to make it look more romantic and make it look more dreamy and use a lot more fancy lighting. And, you know, I mean, look, he's shooting in the city where The Third Man was shot, one of the most amazing cinematography feats of all time. I think they even are on the same Ferris wheel that is featured in that movie, if I'm not mistaken.
I don't remember.
According to Roger Ebert, anyway, they are on the same Ferris wheel at one point. So there would certainly be a temptation to be a little more showy, and I have to give him props for pulling that back and letting the writing and the acting speak for itself.
Yeah, he Lee Daniels does the cinematography for the first two films. He doesn't do the third one. I don't know why he didn't. And I forget the guy who does the person who does the last one, but yeah, he does the first two films, and you can kind of see that in the style of it. I would have liked to see how he would have worked with the third film in terms of it being digital and stuff, and just the fact that that film is quite different in ways we'll get into. Yeah, he does restrain himself, which is good. And when they do in these films kind of cut away to something maybe they're seeing, they do it in a very casual sense and in a very casual way that you would probably have when you're going through these things. Because I know a lot of these things, like, you know, like in the second film, they, not to get jump ahead too much, but they see a very, you know, important historical structure in the city that they're in, and they kind of just vaguely casually reference it. They don't spend too much time on it. And I think in real life, like when I've been to that specific place and looked at that particular building, you know, there's a sense of you want to kind of take it in, but at the same time, you're not as necessarily, some people more than others are doing this, but you're not necessarily having this big, oh, dramatic moment with the thing, necessarily. It is more of just kind of a casual thing. You're taking it in, like, okay, that's cool, and then you go. So I think that, in a way, is more true to life, too, the fact that they aren't spending a lot of time on these things. Yeah, you want to take them in, and it's beautiful, but, you know, I think usually for me, I'm more interested in the person I'm talking to than the things I'm looking at. So, Rosalie, all these films have, should be said, have ambiguous endings to various degrees, but for this film, ignoring the fact that I know you know what happens in these rest of these films and I know what happens in the rest of these films, what, from your point of view, do you just based off the first film and the events of the first film, do you think that they would meet up again?
So when I first watched it, I said they will definitely meet again. Then in subsequent watches, and perhaps because I became a little bit more cynical as I got older, I was like, well, maybe one of them would go, but the other one wouldn't. And then eventually I was like, no, I think they would both go. So now I think I'm back in the camp of they would both try to meet up again.
I go back and forth. I kind of in conflict with my optimism and my practical cynicism, or just maybe cynicism, of romantic side of me says, oh, I would think they would meet back with each other. Since the cynic says, no, they probably wouldn't, but I don't know. I think I'm probably land as in the kind of middle camp that they sort of mentioned the next film, where I don't know if they meet up again, but I hope they do. Again, I'm kind of romantic at heart, so I would hope that they would, but sometimes real world stuff doesn't always work out the way we would want. Now we are together.
Sunshine, but soon we'll
Okay, so on to our next film, Before Sunset, which was made 9 years later, like we said. Came out in 2004, but takes place in the summer of 2003. Like all these films, they take place the year before the years that they came out. And this one has an interesting kind of production in terms of how it got made. Originally, the first film was just going to be it. They didn't have any intentions of making more. And then Richard Linklater was making his film Waking Life. And in that film, there is a cameo with Jesse and Celine, and they worked together with briefly on that scene, and they kind of got back together and they enjoyed that experience. So they thought about, oh, maybe should we revisit these characters from Before Sunrise, which nobody was asking for, but they decided to do it. They wrote it, and this film takes place in, again, the summer of 2003, and takes place in Paris. It is 9 years later. Jesse and Celine are both 32, and it should be said that this little piece, we will have to spoil the ending of Before Sunrise. And for Before Midnight, we'll have to spoil the ending of Before Sunset. So keep that in mind if you haven't seen all these films. But Jesse and Celine did not meet up again after the events of Before Sunrise for reasons we'll probably get into. And Jesse has written a book about their night together. And he is on his last stop of his book tour when he's in Paris. And he's later revealed that he probably almost subconsciously wrote the book as a way to get back and to find her again, because they didn't exchange contact information because, as they said, they were young and stupid and they were afraid that it would fizzle out. And Celine does find him and they meet up. And in the only instance of these films, this film takes place in real time. And over the course of the film is only about 80 minutes, but for about 70 to 75 minutes, they just walk around Paris and talk and catch up about, you know, with their lives, where they've been, and why they didn't meet up and why fate didn't let them meet up again.
Oh, God. Why weren't you there in Vienna?
I told you why.
Well, I know why. I wish you would have been. Our lives might have been so much different.
You think so?
I actually do.
Maybe not. Maybe we would have hated each other eventually.
Oh, what, like we hate each other now?
You know, maybe we're only good at brief encounters, walking around in European cities in warm climate.
Practically, they didn't meet up again because Celine's grandmother, who she mentions in the first film, passed away, and her funeral was on the day that they were going to meet up again before sunrise. So she could not go. Jesse was able to go, and their lives have kind of never been the same since. Jesse is married to somebody. He accidentally got pregnant. They got married because of that. He has a son, a 4 or 5 year old son who he adores. He's not as happy with his marriage. Celine is dating a wartime photographer who's away most of the time, and she's not terribly happy with her relationship with him. They're both trying to make it work, but they're pretty numb inside right now as people. Again, like all these films, there's not a lot of plot. That is pretty much it. They're just talking about these things and these updates and stuff, and about regrets and stuff. And I would say for this film, there is more drama in this one. There's a bit more conflict in this one. And I know that, or I've been led to believe that this one, I think, is a lot of people's favorites of the trilogy, which the first time I saw it, I didn't quite agree with. But I think this time I did like a lot more. And at least out of this viewing of these films, and this could change as, you know, you get older and I have different moods and stuff, but this one was the favorite out of this time that I watched them, not the first time I watched them. The first time it was Before Sunrise, but this one it was Before Sunset, which could change. But anyway, what do you think about this one, Rosalie? Again, especially since a lot of people do consider this one their favorite for whatever reasons.
Yeah, so the first time I watched it, like you, I did not consider it my favorite. In fact, the very first time I watched it, I was like, well, that's kind of a bummer. and I guess it's because, here's why I think that was. The first one is so romantic, yes, and it doesn't necessarily get into the real life consequences of whatever happens. This one is more about the ripple effects of either following through on the romantic notion or not. And seeing it the first time, it was a little jarring because at that point in my life, I really only had maybe one semi-serious relationship. And I was still very much on the, you know, I guess the romantic side of things was different for me. But now that I have revisited it numerous times, I wouldn't say this is my favorite of the trilogy, but man, I really, really love it. And it is super relatable in a lot of ways.
Yes.
that at the time I first watched it, I simply couldn't relate to because I hadn't had those real life experiences. So, you know, not to get overly personal, but, you know, at this point in my life, as I'm talking now, you know, I've experienced and lost love. I have been divorced. I have, you know, gone through the various disappointments that life can bring you. And I've had those dreams where you wake up in a cold sweat because the dream was about a reality that you think you're never going to have again. And so that aspect of it was super relatable. And I think that's probably why this resonates with so many people, mm-hmm. because it's about having that perspective of the 9 years later, looking back and being like, A, I was an idiot, but B, what a happy idiot I was, right? Mm-hmm. And wondering if you can ever recapture that magical feeling again.
You kind of, I think, one, the fact that they're in their early 30s, which I, maybe one reason why I identify with this one so much this time is partially because of personal reasons, and partially because I am almost the age as they were. I am 31 as of this recording, mm-hmm. so I am almost the age as they were in this film. But there is a certain thing in your early 30s where, while I try to hold on to the romanticism of teens and into your, you know, 20s and stuff like that, there is a certain, you know, feeling in your 30s, not just in terms of romance, but in terms of your life, where you feel like you have to have stuff figured out by that point, even if you really don't. Mm-hmm. And you have to kind of know where your life is headed. And, you know, you maybe want to have that special person found already and be settling down with them and all that stuff. And it can be scary when you don't have all that figured out. And I think it's kind of scary for these two that they don't have that figured out. And but at the same time, when you are having stuff that relationships that are not working, yeah, it sucks. And it's, you know, again, like I said, they're very both numb inside, and they're kind of they're living their life. They don't really feel alive, I don't think. Mm-hmm. Just Celine has a line which I think is great, where she says,
"Yes, obviously, I can't deal with the day-to-day life of a relationship. Yeah, we have, you know, this exciting time together, and then he leaves, and I miss him. But at least I'm not dying inside. When someone is always around me, I'm like suffocating. I mean, I'm really happy only when I'm on my own. Even being alone, it's better than sitting next to a lover and feeling lonely."
So, and that's, yeah, true of relationships that have just stopped working, and it's, yeah. It's a film that's very hard to watch in certain respects, because I think the first film, there's this theme of connection that runs throughout all the films, but I think the first film is very specifically about that, and the second film still has that theme of connection, especially reconnection and second chances, but also has a very strong theme of regret in there, of regret mm-hmm. of our lives and things we messed up on or didn't really pursue and stuff, and can we still pursue it, or can we kind of stuck in the lives that we're living and stuff like that. So it is much more difficult to watch emotionally than the first film. I think the films continually get like that, but like you said, they are very, this one's hard to watch, but it's in certain points, but it is very relatable in so many ways, because even if we haven't had the specific things that they have experienced, we've all had elements of that, and we can kind of relate to them. Again, especially as we get old. Again, I think maybe if you watch this when you're a bit young, you might not get, it might not resonate as much. But I think if you maybe wait a little bit, 5-10 years, you will appreciate it a bit more.
Yeah, I do almost think you should wait until you've had your heart broken before you watch Before Sunset. Or at least wait until some part of your life that you have idealized has gone differently than you expected it to. Because that's when it's really gonna both bring you comfort and give you that like gnawing feeling in the pit of your stomach that you so hard identify with these characters, right? And you say it's hard to watch. Like, I don't want to oversell the fact that
no,
I don't want to say it's difficult. I just think you're going to see the recognition of, oh, I have been there, right? Mm-hmm. And I especially like how this one really, it starts off in such a believable place of like, they're both trying to present a version of themselves that like have themselves together and they're doing fine. And like, you know, he's finishing a book tour. People are asking questions and they're like, oh, is it autobiographical? And he's like, everything's autobiographical. Like, I'm not going to get into that. Right. And when he first asks her if she's with somebody, she's like, oh yeah, I'm with this journalist. And he's like, oh, do you love him? And she's like, of course I do, right? So it's very like they're hesitant to unravel those pieces that they've sort of sewn up around themselves to keep themselves safe from feeling that heartbreak again. But the longer they spend together, the more raw and real their conversation gets. And I especially really, really loved the line that Jesse has about how he feels like if somebody touched him, he would dissolve into molecules, because I feel like he is in such tentative place with himself where he's managed to, like, you know, patch himself together, even though he's not with the person he thought he was going to be with. And he's, quote, running a nursery with somebody he used to date, right? That's how he describes his life. But there's still a part of him that's soft inside, and he's trying so hard to protect it, but, like, the smallest thing could disrupt it.
Yeah, he's very, maybe a lot of people now can identify with just being in a very precarious spot emotionally and personally and all that. Obviously, the world is rough right now, so it's hard to kind of have a firm footing in your life right now. But I don't want to oversell that, say that it's like it's a terribly depressing film to watch. I think depending on your mood, it can be very depressing, obviously. But most of it is them getting along and stuff. But one thing I've commended Julie Delpy, Ethan Hawke, and Richard Linklater for doing is they're not afraid to go to very tough emotional places with any of these films. They kind of just go into them, and you just kind of have to stick with it. It might be really tough, but you just have to stick with it. So, but there are scenes that are like that. But I think there is probably, for me, one of the most difficult scenes to watch. It wasn't as hard this time to watch, but maybe because I was prepared for it. But there is a long sequence in a car that they have where they kind of get a lot of this stuff out. And it's, in a way, kind of the climax, emotional climax of the film, where Celine says, she doesn't get angry really at Jesse. She gets really more angry in his general direction, in that she says that,
I was fine until I read your fucking book. It stirred shit up, you know? It reminded me how genuinely romantic I was, how I had so much hope in things, and now it's like, I don't believe in anything that relates to love. I don't feel things for people anymore. In a way, I put all my romanticism into that one night, and I was never able to feel all this again.
And not in a sense that you just get a bit older, maybe a bit more practical, but in the sense that she's really locked herself off and doesn't feel much for her partners that she's had, and that she knows going into that they're not going to work, or she's gotten to that point and she doesn't really try anymore, and she doesn't really feel things for, I think, maybe other people in her lives that aren't romantic relationships. And she's kind of dead inside emotionally and stuff. And the book made her realize that. She's not really mad at Jesse, but she's just mad that she's realized how unhappy she is, really. I think sometimes we can accidentally, you know, we can be going through so much pain emotionally and stuff, and sometimes we don't feel like we can talk about it with other people because we're not comfortable, or we don't think they'll understand it, or whatever. And we can figure out a way to deal with those emotions so that they can go away and we can be happy again. So we kind of, almost without knowing it, kind of numb ourselves so we don't have to deal with that, because that's what, we just don't know what else to do. And I think both of them have done that. I think Celine has definitely done that, especially. She doesn't know how to deal with these emotions, and so she just, over these past 9 years, have slowly numbed herself to everything. And, and is living a very unhealthy, unfulfilling life and stuff. And again, is this very relatable? But again, it's very hard to watch.
Yeah, and it's interesting because, you know, earlier, before that conversation where she really, like, spills her guts, he's talking about,
Do you think it's true that if we never wanted anything, we'd never be unhappy?
I don't know. Not wanting anything, isn't that a symptom of depression?
Yeah, that is, right? I mean, yes, it's healthy to desire, right?
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, it's what all those Buddhist guys say, right? You know, liberate yourself from desire and you'll find that you already have everything you need.
Yeah, but I feel really alive when I want something more than just basic survival needs. I mean, wanting, whether it's intimacy with another person or a new pair of shoes, is kind of beautiful. I like that we have those ever-renewing desires.
Yeah. Yeah, well, maybe it's just a sense of entitlement. You know, like whenever you feel like you deserve that new pair of shoes, you know? I mean, it's okay to want things as long as you don't get pissed off if you don't get them. Yeah. You know, right? Life's hard. It's supposed to be. If we didn't suffer, we wouldn't learn a thing.
And so they're both kind of, they've told themselves things to try to comfort themselves over the years, you know, or again, to like keep those feelings locked away. But I think that her talking about the book like, how many of us are going to have somebody write a book about us? That's probably unlikely. But I think what is relatable here is that some little thing can sometimes unlock whatever pent up feelings you've been hiding away from. And then it just all comes spilling out, right? And there's like no stopping it at that point. And I think that's what that book was for her.
Yeah. And I think, well, and on that kind of similar track, at the beginning of the film, when they're talking just initially about stuff, and, you know, Celine's asking about the book, and they're talking about, you know, how long did it take you to write it and stuff. And they talk about the ending, because the ending of the book is like the ending of the movie in terms of it's open-ended, and you don't know if the fictional Jesse and Celine within the movie, in the book within the movie, whether they met up again. Jesse mentions that, well, he did originally write a scene where they meet up again.
We make love for about 10 days straight. That's
that's interesting.
And
then, yeah. So the French slut, right?
Yeah, okay,
yeah,
great.
Exactly.
Okay.
It's just then they, you know, they start to get to know each other better and they realize that they don't get along at all.
I like that. It's more real.
Yeah, well, my editor didn't think that way.
No, everyone wants to live in love. It sells, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And you can kind of tell, like, they're both trying to justify, like, oh, yeah, that's much more realistic, because they just want to justify, like, oh, if we had met up again, it wouldn't have worked out. So they're trying to kind of justify this to themselves so they don't feel as bad about it. But they secretly both don't feel that way, and but they're trying to, especially in the early scenes where they, you know, haven't opened up to each other as much, they're being very guarded and acting like it's not a big deal. So, yeah, that's just all part of the process and the emotional arc that they go through in these films. And I said that this is the only film that takes place of the trilogy that takes place in real time. What do you think about that aspect of it? Do you like that it takes place in real time?
I do. I think that might also be why this is people's favorite out of the trilogy, because it makes it feel that much more urgent. Because in this one also, he has another plane to catch, right? Jesse's always just jumping onto a plane, leaving Europe. But yeah, I mean, he's supposed to be catching a plane, and we don't know exactly what time it is when his driver tells him, okay, you need to be here by 7:30 to catch the plane. But we get the sense that he's taking more time than he's supposed to. So there's that inward struggle that the viewer has, or at least I had, of, you want him to make the plane because you can relate to the stress of like running through an airport trying to catch a plane, but you also just want him to forget the plane and just reconnect with the love of his life. Mm-hmm. And so the longer the movie goes on, the longer those two sides are kind of like wrestling with each other. And eventually you wonder what decision is going to get made.
I don't know if you felt this way, but it was kind of fascinating to see how much you could get through in like a 75 minute period. In mm-hmm. terms of, I mean, because they get through a lot. I mean, they update yeah. each other about their lives. They go through this huge emotional arc. They talk about deep philosophical, romantic ideas. Their whole relationship changes within this span of time. They go through, again, a lot emotionally in this span of time and get out stuff that they probably haven't told anybody else. And they do it all within, like, you know, I mean, I have enough trouble vacuuming my living room within, like, 70 minutes. And then these people are going through all this stuff. It's just kind of amazing. And again, it's in real time, so they're not cheating. But they're getting through all this stuff. And it's kind of amazing, like, how much you can get through in a little over an hour.
Yeah. It's interesting how the sense of time and the concept of time recurs throughout this movie. And the first movie as well as the last movie. One thing I forgot to mention when we were talking about Before Sunrise is that in Jesse's initial pitch to Celine to get her to get off the train, he says,
jump ahead 10, 20 years, okay? And you're married. And only your marriage doesn't have that same energy that it used to have. You know, you start to blame your husband. You start to think about all those guys you've met in your life and what might have happened if you picked up with one of them, right? Well, I'm one of those guys. That's me. You know, so think of this as time travel from then to now to find out what you're missing out on. See, what this really could be is a gigantic favor to both you and your future husband to find out that you're not missing out on anything. I'm just as big a loser as he is, totally unmotivated, totally boring, and you made the right choice and you're really happy.
I don't think this movie talks about a time machine, but that concept will come up again. And in this movie, there is no time machine, right? They've gone through the pain of the interceding years, and now they know they have to make the most of the time that they have with each other because it's so limited. And so I think it actually even more so than the first film, it has that sense of like, if we don't get it all out there now, we're never going to. So we have to just say what we got to say.
And, you know, and while they're still young people, I mean, they're in their early 30s, there is a sense of having a bit more life lived and stuff. So they, I think, appreciate that time more. There's a line that Celine has where she says,
I guess when you're young, you just believe there'll be many people with whom you connect with. And later in life, you realize it only happens a few times.
Yeah, and you can screw it up, you know, misconnect.
So they appreciate that more, that those really special connections. I mean, you meet with a lot of people who you like, you enjoy, you love, and you spend time with, but those people who you really have a really, 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 really special, unique connection with, that just kind of happens. You can't, like, plan those things. You can't control them. They just sort of happen. Those are very rare. And, you know, it's, some people never get to define that person or people. And they have, and so they know how special their relationship is, and so they treat it with a bit more importance than they maybe they would have even in Before Sunrise.
Yeah, I wanted to go to the anecdote that at the time, I mean, the first time I watched it, even up until I think yesterday, it didn't hit me as hard as this time watching it, where they pass Notre Dame, which, of course, whether you've been to Paris or you've only seen pictures of it, Notre Dame is one of the most beautiful structures I think ever built by human hands. It's absolutely amazing. And they do comment on it as they're passing by it on the boat. And I believe it's Jesse who talks about how during one of the wars, the enemies were supposed to blow up Notre Dame. And so they had planted explosives all throughout. And then they left one guy behind who was supposed to light the match, basically. And that guy could not do it. He couldn't follow through and he couldn't light the match. And so the structure was still there. And what I thought about this time watching it was, this is almost a way of explaining how both he and Celine behave in this movie, in the sense that both of them like have this sense of obligation, like that soldier probably did, of like, we know what we're supposed to do, right? We're supposed to be faithful to our spouse or significant other. We're supposed to be getting on with our lives, but there's something there, some spark that they're like holding onto that is more compelling. And like this one night relationship they had, is their Notre Dame, is too beautiful to just let it go up in smoke. And so they don't necessarily follow what their obligations theoretically should be. And I don't know, that just had more significance watching it this time.
This film, because of the guarded nature of these characters, is in some ways less romantic, less overtly romantic anyway. But it can be, especially near the end of the film, which I won't get into the details of what that is, it can be quite romantic. And there's, I think, two moments I guess I'll share. There's one moment when there's one point when Jesse is having this big monologue about dreams that he's had about Celine, which is obviously just, you know, heartbreaking. And, you know, while he's having these scenes, he's doing the speech and he's kind of breaking down a little bit and crying a little bit and stuff, and his head is turned away from Celine in this car that they're in. Celine, in kind of an echo of a moment that happens in Before Sunrise, she kind of reaches out to him in this very like you know, broken up now a little bit just talking about it. She kind of reaches out to him in this way that she just wants, at least for me, I interpret it as just really wanting to be there for him and comfort him, and just wants him in a, you know, in a romantic sense. And she's heartbroken that he's in pain and stuff, and it's such a touching moment. Very sad, but I think touching and romantic in its own way. And then there's another scene after that where, you know, you mentioned that Jesse talks about how he feels like he's just, you know, if somebody touches him, he's just going to fall apart. And near the end, Celine, you know, hugs him and to see if he will actually do that. And when they pull away, Celine has this moment of just kind of looking at Jesse that is, has, there's so much, there's a bit more lived, there's lived-in quality to her face. There's a bit more a sense of an adult in there. But there's still this great sense of just pure love that she has for him that I think is very touching. And again, there's some stuff that happens after that that's very romantic. But yeah, not as romantic as the first one. It deals with, again, with a lot more harder themes and messages, but I think there is still a romantic fix to get in there. And while I did say that it can be a hard film to watch in certain senses, I think I said in my review for it that it can be very cathartic because it can help you realize you can have second chances, you can deal with these regrets and stuff. I think I've heard Julie Delpy say that she's had a lot of people come up to her and say, oh, you know, I called, you know, this old boyfriend or girlfriend I had, you know, we reconnected, we got married, we have kids now, and all this stuff. So, you know, I think it's, for a lot of people, it was inspiration to reconnect with other people that they kind of lost track of. Well, before we wrap up the discussion on this film, I'm going to come back to the question for the second of three times that I mentioned before. Again, this has an ambiguous ending, and I know you know what happens in Before Midnight, but ignoring that film for the second, what would you think? There's, again, a question of, will Jesse make his flight and they will not stay together, or will he miss his flight and they will kind of get back together or get together? What is your perspective on that? What do you think, ignoring Before Midnight, what do you think would happen?
Well, to quote Nina Simone as Celine, baby, you're going to miss that plane. I definitely think that there's no way they can ignore the spark that is now lit into a small bonfire here. I think they definitely have to stay together.
Yeah, I kind of think so too.
So the final installment in this series, at least for now, is Before Midnight. And that one came out in 2013, was filmed and set in 2012. And once again, features Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy, who, of course, also at this point were heavily involved in the writing of the material as well, besides acting in it. This is a movie that definitely explains and answers the question in the previous one of will they or won't they. In this case, we learn, but not right away, we learn after about 5 minutes or so that they are in fact together. The movie opens with Jesse dropping his now teenage son off at the airport after spending the summer in Greece with Jesse, and he's going back to the U.S. to be with his mom, who we learn isn't a big fan of Jesse. Wonder why that might be. And so, you know, they say their goodbyes. Jesse clearly has some mixed feelings about, you know, having to send his son off on a plane and, you know, wishes he could be with him. He goes out, back out, and we see in the car Celine. And not only is Celine in the car, but we also see the most adorable little golden-haired twin girls sleeping in the back seat, and they somehow look like very, very much like Julie Delpy, despite in real life not being related to her. It's kind of miraculous how they found these little cherubic baby Celines to be in this movie. But yeah, so the movie is now following them 9 years later after the events of the previous film. And they are together. They have these two daughters. And he's still writing. She's still involved in environmental causes, but she's kind of at a crossroads of trying to figure out if she should take a new job or not. And so she's kind of contemplating the pros and cons of that. And they are spending the summer in Greece at another author's home. And they've been there basically for the last 6 weeks. And this is, you know, one of the last weeks they're going to be there. And so it's kind of taking place over the course of a day and a night where they spend some time with their friends. This is really the only one of the three where we get to know other characters besides them. And then they're going to spend the night at a hotel that their friends have kindly gotten for them while they watch the kids. So that's the premise of this movie. And I remember being so excited to see this in the theater because I loved the first two so, so much. And so seeing it in the theater, you know, I tried to avoid knowing anything about it before I went. I don't think I even watched a preview because I wanted to not know.
Oh, you poor
thing. But of course, you have to sort of assume that they are at least in some way going to meet up again. And of course they are in fact together. So then the movie unfolds in a, let me just say, different way than I expected it to when I first saw it. That didn't deter me at the beginning when I first saw it. And actually I liked it more now. This might be my favorite of the three, which is really weird to say, but it might be. So I'm curious what you thought about it.
I always knew going into this one that when they were together and that they were going through some problems. So I was kind of prepared for that and kind of worried about that. As you know, when I originally watched these films, I put this last one off for a long time.
Yep.
Because it is, like I said, I think I hinted at in the last one, these films kind of get more dramatic as they go on, and this one's the most dramatic of them all. It has the most conflict. But it's because, you know, Jesse and Celine are having some, they're not married in the film, but they've been together long term for 9 years, and they're having some trouble. The particular sticking point right now is Jesse wants to find a way, because they're living in Europe, and the second film he talks about how he was putting up with his marriage because he wanted to spend every minute he could with his son. And didn't want to miss anything. And but now is doing that because he wants to be with Celine so badly that he's living in Europe and doesn't get to see his son very much. And his wife, from what we are told, we never see her in any of these films, but she seems very unpleasant. It makes it very difficult for him. They did live in New York for a time, but now they don't. They moved back to Paris so that Celine could have the twins there. And Jesse just wants to find a way to spend more time with his son, find a better arrangement so he can see him more and isn't seeing him so seldomly. And Celine is trying to figure out where she wants to do, if she wants to move on to a different job that she potentially will really like, later says is a dream job, even though Jesse doubts that. And she's hesitant to give all that stuff up, everything she's worked for up, to move to America, especially for what initially is described as just seeing Jesse's son, who she cares about and loves, but only seeing him every other weekend. And so there's a conflict with that. And Jesse and Celine really, like I said, she's kind of neurotic and she kind of worries too much. And this time you can kind of get it, but also at the same time, she's worrying a lot about, she kind of initially, when this conflict initially happens in a very long car scene, she kind of just thinks,
this is where it ends.
What are you talking about?
This is how people start breaking up.
Oh my God. You just jumped off a cliff.
No, no, I'm marking this. This is the day you light the ticking bomb that will destroy our lives. Yeah?
Okay, what? Well, first off, you don't light a ticking bomb. Okay, you set it as a timer.
Whatever.
That's why it
Whatever, okay, it has a timer. Well, you know what? It's ticking right now. And this is how it happens. You're unhappy, you blame it on the other person, resentment grows, everything slowly rot, and you break
up.
You're
just doing this to shut me up.
Not at all.
No, you
are. Not at all.
That's what you're doing.
No. Yeah. No, I'm actually surprised we lasted this long.
Oh, okay. So here comes
I. We're on parallel tracks for a while, but now tracks have crossed, and I'm going west and you're going east. And believe me, this is how it happens. I've seen it, okay? Catherine Alexandre, Thomas.
You're kidding, right?
Well,
you're kidding.
No. I'm kidding. And I'm not.
Well, meanwhile, Jesse's just like, no, I'm just trying to figure this out and stuff. So basically, but this creates a lot of tension between them, a lot of doubts about the future of their relationship, and can be depressing. But I think the first film and the second film deal with this kind of pure romantic idealized love thing, and this third one kind of deals with the everyday practicality of being in love with somebody and being in a relationship with somebody. And while there are, like I said, there are different ways you can interpret this film, and we'll talk about how we think about the ending of the film when we get to the end of this one, but there's, I think, two ways you can interpret this film. You can interpret it as kind of something they talk about in the first one, and they kind of restate in the third one with the younger couple that, you know, love isn't always forever, and that can be heartbreaking, but it can also be okay. Like, why do they have to last forever? Or you can just note it as, which I think is the, even though they leave it up to interpretation, the intention, I think, of Ethan Hawke, Julie Delpy, and Richard Linklater, in that, you know, relationships are hard. And they're a lot of work. So I think the film kind of very much deals with that. They're in the work part of their relationship, which I think is really interesting. And I think very rare for films to delve into that, especially with long-term relationships. Usually when you get into this stuff, it's explicitly about relationships failing and not working and will eventually lead to divorce and separation. So I think this one leaving it open and just discussing this in a more real, practical sense is unique and interesting.
Yeah, this is one where I feel like all those little asides that felt insignificant in the first two movies, those birds come home to roost. So to speak. You know, for example, in Before Sunrise, they have this interaction where they're like joking around like, oh, is this our first fight? But it's about the palm reader. And, you know, Celine says that Jesse is a little bit too self-obsessed and that he was bothered by the fact that she wasn't paying as much attention to him. And, you know, he also is a bit competitive, right? And they're playing pinball. And then in Before Sunset, you know, they have this conversation about her work for the environment. She's doing that in that movie as well. And, you know, Jesse's like, oh, I think the world is getting better and, you know, people are more aware. And Celine's like, no way, it's getting way worse. Like, corporations can get away with anything now. And, you know, like, the world is kind of like going to hell, and she's much more negative in that sense. This movie, those two little conflicts really come to fruition even more, and we see them as deeper character traits where, again, they're talking about the environment and her role at her job is, you know, to try to really advocate for change, and she's kind of meeting obstacle after obstacle. And his main obstacle is just like writer's block, which he doesn't even really have, right? So he seems to be living a much more free life to kind of do what he wants. And she's the one that ends up having to do a lot of work or make a lot of sacrifices. And they even talk about, you know, they seem to be joking, but there's certainly a passive aggressive honesty that's running through the conversation when they're chatting with their friends where, you know, they'll say, oh, those books that he wrote about, you were so romantic. And she's like, well, it's not as romantic if you know, like, all the behind the scenes stuff, right? That he was married and he had to leave his wife and there was a custody battle. And, you know, the first time we had sex with no condom, it broke or whatever. And now we have twins. So, you know, she's definitely like letting some of her resentments show. And on the other hand, he feels like she's being dramatic, but he's also kind of minimizing perhaps the valid points that she's making.
Yeah, I think there's a bit of both ways. I mean, I know one thing it was interesting. I saw them say when they were talking about, I think maybe the films as a whole, but especially this one, is that they were not afraid of Ethan Hawke and just Julie Delpy were not afraid to make their characters unlikable at certain points. And they are, I think ultimately, hopefully they, you know, you would want to like them. But yeah, you can understand. I think they're both not treating the situation as well as they could. Like you said, Jesse's probably minimizing stuff a bit too much and is kind of living in this fantasy realm of, like Justin Celine says, of socks just get picked up and things get put away and food gets made by these special magical elves and stuff. And then Celine certainly has a right to complain about these things and feel like she's had too much the brunt of work and sacrifice over the past 9 years. But at the same time, in certain ways, is blowing stuff out of proportion to a certain extent, like instantly going to our relationship is doomed, or going to, you know, Jesse points out that, like, oh, yes, you're so a horribly oppressed woman. Yes, you grew up in comfortable middle-class Paris. Yes, your life is terrible, blah, blah, blah. So you can kind of get both points of view in that. You agree with both of them and disagree with both of them at the same time. And that complexity makes it more real.
The conversation they have in the hotel room, that fight is so visceral and so honest that it's almost hard to believe they aren't really fighting. And so I watched the short documentary that was made during this film. It's called After Before. And that's also on the Criterion channel right now. I'm assuming it's also on the disc version. And so it's very interesting to see them rehearsing these and like laughing in between takes and like, you know, revising as they're going through.
Oh, and they said that it was fun to shoot those scenes, they said.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like, wow, you know, it feels so... heavy would be the wrong word, because I feel like it's not heavy. It's just you can relate. Even if you disagree with what both of them are saying, you also can kind of see both of their points. And so every time I watch this, I feel like I'm on a different side of, like, the first time I watched it, I was like, oh, I'm Team Jesse, like, all the way. Then the second time I was like, well, you know, he definitely is, like, minimizing what she's going through and is just trying to be the funny guy and be the hero to come in and save the day and doesn't want to actually face the reality of the situation. And he's almost repeating his old patterns because he left things a shambles with his ex-wife. Now he's kind of mucking around on this one and he just wants to pretend like it's all fine. And she's like, no, we have to confront this and deal with it. Right. So this time watching it, I could kind of see both of their points, but I also could sort of see how both of them just do this and like kind of goad each other, right? Like, you can tell that this is not untrodden territory. They've had some version of this argument before, but maybe not to this extent. Mm-hmm. And he says numerous times, like, you're nuts, you're crazy, which I don't like. I hate it when men do that to women that they disagree with. But at the same time, you're like, okay, she also does invoke the final solution and talks about like feminism in this such a grand term that she's kind of lumping Jesse in with, like, this grand tradition of men oppressing women. And, you know, he's got some faults, but he's not the worst man there is either by any stretch of the imagination. And so you can definitely see both sides.
Well, yeah. I mean, one of the things that's great about that hotel argument, which again is very, it's a lot. And it starts off, that scene starts off romantic, but very quickly becomes very not romantic at all. And it's probably the least romantic part of any of these films. What I find very interesting that I noticed this time around is that it's very good. It's a kind of a masterclass example of the flow of an argument can have, where mm-hmm. they're fighting really harshly, and then just seemingly out of nowhere, they very easily and naturally and believably transition into a calmer bit of situation where they just suddenly start calming down a little bit. And they're getting along a little bit better, talking a bit more rationally, and then they start arguing again. Or, you know, maybe at one point Celine leaves briefly the room, then comes back, and then they continue, and she's a bit more sad this time than angry, and they calm down a little bit, they talk a bit more rationally, and then they get some stuff that gets on their nerves a bit more again, they start arguing again. But it goes back and forth, which it happens with arguments, and also makes sense from a structural point of view of calming, you know, not overwhelming your audience with fight, you're giving them a bit of time to breathe before you're going back to them fighting again. So it makes sense in terms of pacing, it makes sense in terms of believability, and it's very well written, very well acted, that stuff.
Yeah, the thing that I love about it, and actually I loved it the most this time, was you feel like you're watching two people who actually really do love and care about each other fight, because the stakes of their fight are so high. And so, yes, they're being petty, they're saying nasty stuff that I'm sure they're going to feel bad about later, and they're airing grievances that they've been hanging on to for a long time. There's resentments, you know, things like that. But the core of it is, how are we going to make our relationship work, right? And what exactly does our relationship look like going forward? So I almost feel like, even though they're fighting with each other, they're also fighting for each other. It's just kind of figuring out how they're going to get there. And it reminds me of that scene earlier on where Celine is in the kitchen with some of the other women and they're making dinner and, you know, chopping vegetables or whatever. And the other woman's husband comes in and, you know, he's pretending like he's going to help them, but she's like, oh, he doesn't cook. Like, I always do the cooking. And they have knives and they're both kind of like chopping the vegetables and arguing with each other. And Celine's like, oh, stop fighting with knives. Like, she's so stressed out. And they laugh and they're like, oh, we're not fighting, we're negotiating. This is our system. And so I feel like in this scene in the hotel, this is Jesse and Celine's system. Like, they kind of have to have it out every so often to kind of figure out the right way forward. And that is how real relationships and real love is, where hopefully it doesn't get too heated, where you don't say things that you can't take back. But also, it's important to have some emotional honesty in your relationship so that you don't just bottle it up like they were all doing in Before Sunset.
Earlier in the film, we do see them get along. Most of this film is them getting along, maybe a bit not as easily as they were in the other films, but they are getting along and they're joking and stuff. And when we first see them, they are getting along and laughing and stuff. So those things work and you have hope for their relationship because you can see them still having a good time. Before they have this argument, you never know exactly what's going on inside of somebody. They can seem like they're having a good time, but maybe they're not. But it seems like before this argument starts in this hotel room that they are having a good time, you know, and they're going to have some sexy fun time and genuinely enjoy and love that and stuff. So I think that helps set what they're fighting for and let you show that they do have hope. It's not just, you know, hour and 40 minutes of them fighting. But to get away from the argument stuff for a second, to get something a little bit lighter. Okay, so I don't think this is going to be telling a tale out of school, because if it's telling on anybody, it's telling on myself. But one of my, the line that probably sticks in my head out of all these films the most, it's very silly. It doesn't really mean anything in a deep sense. It is not my favorite emotionally. It just, for some reason, sticks in my head because I find it really personal. there's a scene where, in that hotel room, when they're not getting along as much, they've had tried to have sexy fun time. It doesn't quite work. And then at one point, Celine is criticizing Jesse and says,
"You like to have sex the exact same way. Every time.
When you got it, you got it.
Kissy, kissy. Titty, titty. Pussy."
I always find that. So, one, it's funny. I don't know if it's supposed to be funny, but I find it funny.
And oh, I also think it's find, funny.
And I think it's a bit of a personal attack. I won't go too far into that, but I've been accused of similar things. But so, yeah, just to get to a lighter note, I find that line, I don't know. I think about that line a lot, and I don't, it's so silly.
No, that line is hilarious. And I think what you're getting to is an important point, which is even when they're fighting and mad at each other, they still say and do some really funny stuff. And I think Celine in particular has some hilarious lines. Like when she's upset, sometimes the funniest stuff comes out. Like when she says,
"The only time I get to think now is when I take a shit at the office. I'm starting to associate thoughts with the smell of shit."
That's also hilarious.
And, you know, and again, talk about lighter stuff. When they're not arguing, there's funny stuff too. Like one scene that's really funny. There's two things. One, there's Jesse at a couple points does some vague European accent.
"I don't ogle girls. Like you think I don't ogle girls. I make love to them with my eyes."
Oh, wow. "I like the Spanish guy. Or is it Greek?
I don't know where I'm from, but I'm very hairy."
Then later when he does it again, where they're walking and talking, he's like,
"The nectar of your sex ages like a fine wine."
Uh-oh, my hairy Spanish lover is back.
Greek. I'm Greek now, Greek, for sure. Yeah. Greek, yeah.
Yeah, and he says he's a billy goat, a billy goat. Thought was fun.
And, but then there's another scene where they are role-playing again at the dinner or lunch, whatever meal they're having, at the meal table with their friends, where she says, Justine says that his greatest secret, he's a closeted macho and that he really just wants a bimbo for a wife. And so she pretends to be, puts on this air of this bimbo-like character and stuff. And she's like,
"So you're a writer?"
Yeah, sure.
"So you write, like, books?"
"I've read a few."
Sure.
Yeah.
"Wow. I've never met a writer before."
"No.
You what? Must be really smart." "Wow. You know, I can't even write my own name sometimes when I'm tired."
"Oh. What kind of books do you like, huh?"
"Well, I like stories with a meaning behind it, like a really beautiful love story."
"Oh, sure, yeah."
"You know, I read this book once, Romeo and
Juliet." "Right?"
"Yeah."
"Oh, yeah.
Wow, well, you know it."
"It's very good, yeah. It's a play, actually. It's not a book, a play. It's just..."
"Oh, I thought it was a book based on the movie."
"No."
It's this great little thing and stuff, and, you know. And yeah, it's very funny. So there is funny stuff in there and stuff that's really great.
Yeah, and it's important that they are laughing and that they do have this humor, because that is a callback in itself to in Before Sunset, where they're on the boat and he talks about his marriage at the time and he says, "There's no laughter in our house." And Celine just thinks that's like so sad. And I think the fact that there's still laughter between these two is a really hopeful thing. It means that they still have that magnetic connection, even if it can be tried at times.
One thing I find interesting about this film is that the first film, Before Sunrise, it's around the same length as this one. The second film is about 80 minutes. These other two are about 100 minutes, around an hour 40. This one is the longest. But it's interesting that it's the longest, but it felt so much shorter than the first one, at least in this view.
Yeah.
The first one, it's an hour and 40. The first time I watched it especially, and I was pausing a bit too, so that helps. But and then the second time I watched it, it felt like all this time, like a long period of time was going by, and scenes went on and on. I just felt like a much longer film. And then this one, it just felt a lot shorter. And I wonder if Linklater, and maybe in the writing too, if the others, they tried to instill the film of that intentionally in terms of, you know, as I think it's something that's kind of talked about, how Jesse in this film talks about how when he was younger, he just wanted time to speed up so he could be older. Now that he's older, he wants stuff to slow down. And in the first film, I think as you're younger, stuff, those nights can seem like they last a long time. And then when you're older, they mention how it should be said there's very little walking and talking in this film. And a series that's made itself off of walking and talking, there's like 20 minutes. They spend like an 20 minutes showing where the characters have been and with a car scene. Then they spend about 20 minutes with those other characters, which again is the longest amount of time they spend with other characters. And then they spend 20 minutes together, and then they spend the last 30, 40 minutes or so on that hotel sequence and the aftermath of that. But yeah, only like 20 minutes of them walking and talking. And maybe that's why it seems so much shorter, is that they don't, and they talk about how they don't really get to do that anymore because they have kids and stuff. And they talk about how they're just walking, and all of a sudden, like, do you hear that? It's like, what? Then they're like, oh, there's no tiny footsteps and stuff. And they talk about how, hey, we can have sex and then we can go to sleep and then have sex again in the morning without a child sitting on our head, which is very relatable, having a child. And yeah, you have less time for that. I think just as adults, let alone being adults with kids and a family, it is harder to do that stuff. So time goes by much quicker. So yeah, I wonder if that was intentional to make it seem like this film goes by a lot. Because all of a sudden, you're like, I was aware of where we were in the film. I was like, oh, this film's almost over. And it, you know, so it just felt like time was going by much faster in this film, which I found very interesting. But I think you get some interesting stuff in there, like, again, this idea of, is romance, is it okay? Because these younger couple in the film, they're probably in their 20s or something. And, you know, they're like, yeah, we're probably going to break up at some point, you know. And they're very resigned to the fact that, you know, love doesn't have to be forever and stuff, which Jesse and Selena are a bit about. And the older couple that they're friends with kind of are in a similar thing of not putting all of their hopes on this big idyllic romantic love thing. But they're still very much in love and they very much care about each other. And Jesse and Selena are still a bit like, about that. So what I was mentioning earlier in the Before Sunrise part is that their big romantic idealism of love is in a way kind of in their way a little bit. Because they kind of thought that one of the messages of the film, and Jesse kind of basically says this, is that because Selena talks about how, you know, their twins, you know, every movie to them ends with somebody getting married. And basically, they don't say this specifically, but this idea of you get married and you live happily ever after. And Jesse later comes back to that and gets on Celine.
You know something? You're just like the little girls and everybody else. You want to live inside some fairy tale, all right? I'm just trying to make things better here, all right? I tell you that I love you unconditionally. I tell you that you're beautiful. I tell you that your ass looks great when you're 80. All right? I put up with plenty of your shit. And if you think I'm just some dog who's going to keep coming back, then you're wrong. But if you want true love, then this is it. This is real life. It's not perfect, but it's real. And if you can't see it, then you're blind.
And Jesse's more aware of that than Lena is, but they both have a lesson to learn of, like, just because we're together now doesn't mean things are going to be perfect. And these other couples, I think, more easily have figured that out because they didn't go into it with a big, hey, we're going to find the person we're meant to be with, and everything's going to be perfect after that.
So I have a couple more thoughts I want to share, but I want to put a big old spoiler warning here in case for some reason you're listening and you have not yet seen this movie, because I am going to talk about some stuff that comes at the very, very end. So if you don't want to know about it, then skip ahead a couple minutes and you'll be none the wiser until you actually watch the movie. So that being said, earlier we talked about that sense of time in these movies, right? And how Jesse in the beginning talks about, oh, you getting off the train with me, it's like getting in a time machine. And that time machine thing comes up again in this movie as a device that he uses after Celine has walked out and said basically she's not sure if she still loves him. He uses that in a sweet but sort of funny, charming way to get her to give him another shot.
I'm a time traveler. I've come to save you just like I said I would.
Save me from what?
Save you from being blinded by all the little bullshit of life.
It's not bullshit. Jesse, this is not a game. You get all cute, you get in my panties, and next thing I know, I'm buying peanut butter in Chicago. You're not going to make it better by some little pickup line.
I'm not trying to pick you up. No, no, you misunderstand me. No. I'm only here as a messenger. I just traveled all the way from the future. I was just with your 82-year-old self who gave me a letter.
Do you want me to read it to you?
Do I have a choice?
Oh, sure. I mean, if you're not interested in what you have to say.
No. Read it.
I'm sending you this young man. Yes, young. And he will be your escort. God knows he has many problems and has struggled his whole life, connecting and being present even with those he loves the most. And for that, he is deeply sorry. But you are his only hope.
And I love that scene so, so much of him in his Jesse way of like being super light and silly when she's trying to be serious. Like he needles around and he uses this concept of the time machine to get her to pay attention. What did you think about that scene?
Well, it's a touching scene. You can understand why she's kind of pissed off, because I think we've all had moments, at least I have, where I'm mad and I kind of just want to be mad for a bit. But yeah, he's trying to make it light. He's trying to call back. And I think in a way, because there's this accusation that, you know, he's not this big romantic person that he used to be, that she fell in love with. And in that scene, he even talks about, it's like, you know, that romantic, when he gets a bit more serious, it's like that romantic guy, he's still there. But yeah, it's touching, it's complex. So it's left open-ended, like all these films, of will they stay together, will they won't. Like, again, is this a, again, I think really, is this a message, is this a movie about a love ending, and is that okay, or is this just a bump in the road? Because again, we don't notice, like, see the other times they have together, this could be, they could have gone along great before this and great after this, for all we know. This could just be a very bad day for them, which happens. And we don't know, while they idealize these other relationships they're seeing, we don't know what's going on behind the scenes of their relationships. We're just seeing the good parts, we're not seeing the bad parts of it. So we don't know exactly how things are, but from this picture, it looks pretty rough. But we aren't told what's going to happen, if this is just a bump in the road for them and they'll figure stuff out and they'll be okay. But what do you think? Do you think if they were to make a fourth film, what do you think, that they would still be together, or do you think they would be apart? There are stories you could tell with both.
I think they're together. I think that they've maybe settled in a little bit more to themselves. And at this point, you know, 9 years on, all the kids are older, right? I don't know how old the girls were meant to be in this movie, but probably like 7 or 8.
So maybe they 5 or 6, least, but yeah.
Okay. But they would be at least teenagers, right? And, you know, obviously Hank would be in his 20s. So I think that that part of their lives having calmed down, maybe they do have more time to make for each other. And they've also probably gotten better at sort of negotiating the terms of who makes the sacrifices and who doesn't. And just knowing what the real world has to offer, and I don't want the real world to creep into these movies in some ways, you know, maybe Celine's work has become more around not just the environment, but maybe she's doing something for health advocacy, right? Or who knows, right? But I do think that they're together. That's my opinion.
And I think Judy Delpy talked about how, because initially there was some talk, there's something that she kind of missed. She was misquoted, or she was just kind of misinterpreted, because maybe she misspoke, that they had proposed, initially it was thought that they proposed, Ethan Hawke and Richard Linklater proposed a fourth one to her, and she said no. But she later revealed, no, we had talked about it, and we all decided no. Because basically, I guess the only idea they could all talk about in unison, none of them liked. She didn't say what the idea was. But I think, since I think their point of it, even though they leave it open, they are in, again, the point of view of this movie's about relationships are not perfect, they could still work. To make them separated in any future films, but especially the fourth one, it would kind of make the third film kind of pointless. And make it less special, because I'm not saying there's nothing to be talked about, like, you know, love not being forever and stuff, but that's more of a common theme you see in films. It is such a much more of a rare thing to talk about relationships long term not being perfect. So right. It would make the third film a lot less special, I think.
Maybe it's okay if they wait a little bit longer, right? Yeah. Maybe they're waiting until the characters would be more, you know, close to that retirement age or something like that. I'm very curious, but I feel like right now it's ended in the perfect spot for who I am and what I relate to. So I'm okay with where it has ended. And I like having that hopeful note that it goes out on to kind of imagine what might come next.
Yeah. Okay, so why don't we talk about some stuff that's coming up through some of these boutique labels. We'll start with Criterion. I think Rosalie and I made a mistake last time, and we missed and forgot to mention some Criterion coming up, so we're going to try to go through some of these lightning style just to kind of catch everybody up if you haven't looked over there yourself. So just really quick, I'm going to mention some, then Rosalie's going to pinpoint a few. So we have for September, Takeout, Le Corbeau. I know I'm mispronouncing that probably. I apologize. We have a fourth volume of Martin Scorsese's World Cinema Project. I'm excited about that. We have, for people who were paying attention to the Oscars a couple years ago, I think it was, we have Sound of Metal. That's at the end of September. In October, we have a little-known film called Night of the Living Dead. And then we have, and this is exciting for the podcast, this was already released through Kino. It just recently ran out of print at Kino, the Blu-ray of it. But Criterion is going to release, I think it's a Blu-ray and a 4K of Lost Highway from David Lynch, starring Bill Pullman and I think Patricia Arquette. Then there's also in October going to be Arsenic and Old Lace by Frank Capra and Cary Grant with a really wonderful cover that I adore. Then we have La Llorona. Then we have not The Cure, which I almost said. We have Cure. And then I think there was a few films that Rosalie wanted to highlight.
Yes, thank you. So first and foremost, just out of time, Blowout, which we're actually going to be talking about in August, is going to be coming out on Blu-ray on September 6th from Criterion. But I already have the Criterion DVD, so I mean, you know, I'm covered for now, but it'll be cool to have that out. Exotica, wonderful movie from Adam Egoyan, Canadian director who doesn't get enough love, I feel. And this movie also has really cool cover art. If you've never seen it, very much worth your while. I'm taking us away from our rapid fire style, I realize, sorry, but it's so good. And then last but not least, a movie that I've had on my at least famous to me spreadsheet of this should get a Criterion release. Eve's Bayou, directed by the amazing Casey Clemons, is finally going to be on Criterion on October 25th. On the not on Criterion side of coming soon, we have a few that I am really excited about. The first one being Cool World. So you may remember during our adult animation segment, we talked about a Ralph Bakshi film. Cool World is one of his more famous and one of his more recent in quotes because it's from the 90s. But Cool World is a phenomenal little movie with an amazing soundtrack that has been out of print for quite some time, I believe. So it's cool that it's coming to Shout Factory. And then, of course, I wouldn't be myself if I didn't mention and highlight Kino's latest installment in film noir, The Dark Side of Film. This is actually their 10th volume. And it features not one, but two movies starring my beloved Tony Curtis. Flesh and Fury is one, which I have seen and I love, in which he plays a boxer with hearing loss. And then we also have The Square Jungle. And finally, a movie that I don't think he's in, World in My Corner. So I'm very excited about those.
And then two things I would like to highlight. One from Flickr Alley. There is the 1927 French silent film Casanova. And something I am very excited for. I think Kino keeps going above and beyond and not disappointing with highlighting lesser known areas of film history. And they're releasing a set that I think a lot of people are excited about called Cinema's First Nasty Women. Great title in my opinion. And and it has I'll just read a little bit of the summary of it. I'll probably do a better job of it than I could. This four-disc set showcases more than 14 hours of rarely seen silent films about feminist protests, slapstick, rebellion, and suggestive gender play. These women organize labor strikes, bake and weaponize inedible desserts, explode out of chimneys, electrocute the police force, and assume a range of identities that gleefully dismantle traditional gender norms and sexual constraints. The films span a variety of genres, including slapstick comedy, genteel farce, the trick film, cowboy melodrama, and adventure thriller. Cinema's First Nasty Women includes 99 European and American silent films produced from 1898 to 1926. Search from 13 international film archives and libraries with all new musical scores, film introductions, commentary tracks, and lavishly illustrated booklets. And there's more stuff that I don't want to read. But sounds very exciting. And I will be definitely get that when I have the chance and the money to do that. But as some of you may know, I know this podcast will be released very late in the month, but if you still have time when you listen to this and July is not yet over, you may want to get some last minute purchases from not only the Criterion sale, but the Arrow sale as well. Both of them are doing 50% off sales through the end of July with Barnes & Noble. But some of the stuff that I have gotten, I got from Arrow. I got the Kevin Smith film Mallrats. Then we have a film that we talked about on the podcast already, I think last October, The Bird of the Crystal Plumage, which I enjoyed quite a bit. And then finally from Arrow, I had gotten the for their Thousandth Spine, Criterion had released Godzilla set of the first 15 films that Japan had made for Godzilla. And from that same era of Godzilla films, Arrow has released a Gamera set of 8 films. So excited for those. And finally, for Criterion, I got a little-known movie called Citizen Kane. I got the third volume of Scorsese's World Cinema Project. It will sit nicely next to my so far unwatched volume 1 and 2 of his World Cinema Projects.
Soon to be volume 4.
Soon to be volume 4, yeah. I'm great at watching these. And then finally, one of the things I did want to get, they didn't have it in stock. I actually did have to order it just because I really, really wanted it. A set we have talked about on the podcast in one of our early episodes, the Andre Gregory and Wallace Shawn 3 films sets with My Dinner with Andre, Vanya on 42nd Street, and the plucky comedy A Master Builder. That was my theme for this year. What did you do this year, Rosalie?
Well, somewhat shockingly, I still have to go and get something because... I know. Okay, so listen. I had major car issues that were much more expensive than anticipated. So I was a responsible adult and got my car fixed instead of buying more movies.
You can walk.
I know. Well, you know, it's hard to carry cat litter the several miles it would be from my house to the nearest place.
You get your workout that way, you know.
I would.
I mean,
I would.
Illinois is so cool this time of year. I think it should be fun.
Isn't it, though? Yeah. So I haven't purchased these yet, but here's what's on my wish list. We'll see what I end up with. I'll report back next month. So from Arrow, if I can track these down, ideally I would like to pick up Gas Food Lodging, which I do have on DVD, the Allison Anders film, but I don't have it on Blu-ray, and the Arrow one just looks so pretty. So I'd love to get that. Crimes of Passion is another one that I'm very interested in from Arrow. That one is directed by Ken Russell, and it stars Anthony Perkins and Kathleen Turner, two standout people that I think will be interesting in this probably twisted movie from Ken Russell. He's known for that. And then there's a film noir that is directed by Joseph H. Lewis called My Name is Julia Ross. And it's fantastic. I watched it actually on the Criterion channel, ironically enough, but it's coming out on, or it's out on Arrow. So that's another one that I would like to pick up. And then on the Criterion side, the two I've had my eye on recently could not be more different. One of them is Female Trouble by John Waters, starring Divine. And the other is Destry Rides Again with Jimmy Stewart and Marlena Dietrich. But somewhere there, I'm sure Divine and Marlena Dietrich shared some DNA. So
probably
those are my picks.
Okay. And before we wrap up, just a quick preview of what we have coming up in the next few months. Next month, or in August, we're going to sort of celebrate Rosalie's birthday by talking about some films that came out, I believe, was the year that she was born. I think that's correct, right?
Yeah, the summer I was born, even. Yeah,
summer. So we're going to talk about two films, Blowout, which we just... Rosalie just mentioned a little bit ago, and the John Carpenter film Escape from New York. And then in September, some of you may remember that last September we talked about some early teleplays, basically, I guess you can maybe call them TV movies now or whatever, that were released in the early days of American television in the early to mid-50s. And that was part of the Criterion set, the Golden Age of Television. That set, there are 8 teleplays. We talked about the first 4 last year. We're going to talk about the last 4 this year. And then for October, exciting, we're going to talk about some Hitchcock films, finally. We're going to talk about The Lodger, A Story of London Fog, which is a silent film. And then Notorious. But in the meantime, if you want to check us out or our parent company out, you can find our parent company's website at 25yearslatersite.com and its Twitter account at 25ylmedia. And in its then the bio for its main Twitter page, you can find links to some of its kind of sub-Twitter pages and all that. If you want to find me on Twitter, you can find me at CinemaPackerOut, where you can find links to my YouTube channel, where, as of this recording, you can find reviews of Before Sunrise, which I did last October 2021, and just recently, this July of 2022, a review of Before Sunset. There will be a review of Before Midnight coming, probably sooner rather than later, but I have some other stuff I have to get done first. Some exciting stuff, so keep your eye on that. There'll be an announcement for some cool stuff that I'm really excited about on there. But you can find links to my YouTube channel in my Twitter bio.
And you can find me on Twitter at Rosalie Lewis. You can also find my writing and occasional podcast appearances at fthismovie.com.
And until next time, why don't you go find somebody and talk and connect with them?
Αδιάφορα τριγύρω μου να κοιτώ. Στο γυμνό λαιμό μου το χέρι σου να παίρνει.